be there's some interaction with an insect, and in this case it's a monarch. But really, when you, I don't want to sound too cynical, but when you look at a flower, remember what a flower is. A flower is a gaudy, stinky way for a plant to hoodwink an insect into coming on over and tussling all over its private parts. I mean, that really is how it is. I mean, look at this thing. This, it's a showy pentamen. It's just saying, in here, stupid. I mean, this is what it's saying to a bumblebee. And it works. Next one here, I think we have a thistle coming up. Here is a busy little bumblebee hitting what? What is this bumblebee doing? Sure, it's after nectar. Nectar is a real sweet liquid that this flower is sort of rewarding this bumblebee for. But bumblebee is also doing something, or could be doing something, it's also gathering pollen to bring back and use for food. Butterflies kind of bypass the pollen route. There's only a couple butterflies that utilize pollen at all, but they do utilize nectar. This is their energy source. It's pretty much a pure energy source for moving around. And I think we're going to come up to a white space in this thing, and I'm going to want to change to a set aside. No, two things. You can plant your own garden like I did here. This is about part of an acre prairie that I planted. You have oxi, you have fragrant hyssop. You can plant things, you can bring butterflies into your own backyard, or you can take advantage of some of these beautiful things that the DNR or the Nature Conservancy has set aside. This is a little stretch down by down off of a railroad right away in southern Minnesota, where we have all kinds of gorgeous native plant communities with maybe 150 or 200 different kinds of plants. I'm going to show this and I'm going to go to the first slide. Can I get the first slide for two? Okay, I'll have one more time. Anyone recognize this? Sure, tiger swallowtail. Beautiful looking organism, these beautiful colors on it, all thanks to tiny, tiny little individual scales on this thing. Typical butterfly, typical insect, what do you have to say? Three body parts, four wings. We all know that kind of stuff. Next one, please. But even some of the drab ones, even a cabbage butterfly like this, still have a certain kind of a beauty to them. All these little fine scales. If you look at these things just under a hand lens, instead of trying to squish them as they're egg laying on your broccoli or cauliflower, they're still really kind of pretty. And I'm just going to go through some of the kind of major groups of butterflies in Minnesota just so we have an idea of what we're all talking about here. Whites are, there may be about four or five species in Minnesota. They're as larvae, they feed on the crucifers. Cabbages being on broccoli, wild crucifer, a lot of the weeds in the alfalfa fields. Next one, please. Then we have these, sulfurs, alfalfa butterflies, or common sulfurs. Next one. This is just a common sulfur, that previous one with a male alfalfa butterfly. Next one, please. And if you want to have a little bit of a nightmare, you can try to be a taxonomist and figure out, the females can be white, or they can be orange, or they can be yellow, or they can be white, or they can crossbreed, and you get all these sort of mix and match type things. But here again, still, they're beautiful. They're just exquisite to look at. They're fun to photograph. They're fun to go out and look at through your binocs. They're even sort of fun to have flitting around in your backyard to show the kids or watch what they're doing. Next slide, please. There are a couple. These are the common ones that you're going to see around here. Does anyone know what this one is here? Sure, it's a dog face. It's not often seen in Minnesota. Neither is this. This is a what's called a dainty sulfur. Both of these live down south. They fly up north sometimes, many of them some year, sometimes none of them some year. But we'll get these migrants coming up from, say, Missouri, from Kentucky, from two or three states further on south. Next one, please. dog face. I think this one maybe was taken just a little bit outside of Camp Ripley, but you see the face is sort of looks like Snoopy or the poodle up there. Dainty sulfur, small sulfur, that's another sulfur. All these are migrants that will occasionally get into Minnesota. And this one sort of makes butterfly collecting and butterfly viewing kind of fun. You never know quite what you're going to get. You have your sort of basic stock, but maybe something's sneaking in from the west or something's coming up from the south, or you found a little patch of native prairie or something that you only have a nice little localized population. Next one, please. Here are just some of these whites. These are the cabbage or crucifer feeding ones, sharp veined white. The names aren't that important, but you're familiar with the cabbage butterfly. Here are just some of its cousins that you're going to see fairly early in the spring, particularly with this one here. Next one, please. Comma, Compton's tortoise, morning cloak. Question mark, comma, one of the several commas. These are a large group, the biggest group of butterflies in Minnesota. They're called four-footed or bush-footed or nymphalids. Beautiful looking thing. I think this Compton's tortoise is probably one of the most beautiful looking butterflies in the United States. Next one here. A painted lady. When I was up at Ripley, I was thinking of writing a little thing for the paper about Camp Ripley invaded by painted ladies. There was in 1992, there was an absolutely incredible migration up from Texas of painted ladies. And these things were going, some of them end up in central, even I think northern Canada. They looked fairly good at first, but as time went on, it got a little bit ragged. But my 19-year-old daughter driving back from college in Menominee said, "Dad, why are all the butterflies flying across I-94? I mean, and this is a kid who absolutely hates science and noticed that many butterflies. 92 was really a whale of a year for migrants coming up. Okay, next one, please. A close related American painted lady. And sometimes if you're observing butterflies, looking at butterflies through binocs, sometimes you have to look at the underside. Here's where you look on these to tell it from a very similar species. If you get really good, maybe you can tell monarchs and viceroys just by the way they fly. But at first, sometimes you have to oftentimes look on the underside. Next slide, please. This is what happens after you've flown all by yourself 1,800 miles, laid 600 eggs, fought off numerous suitors and several birds, and it's time to call Krakowian, I think. But anyway, this is not what you'd normally see in the butterfly cases, but I couldn't resist putting that one on a pin. Okay, next one, please. Question mark, you tell by these funny little thing that looks like a question mark, comma down here. These things are neat because they're brightly colored on the outside, and then when they fold up their wings, they're really very, very, very camouflaged. This is the undersides of question mark and comma. Next slide, please. A Baltimore. It's interesting. Some of the larvae, well, of many species of butterflies, will have pretty broad taste in host plants, and they'll eat just about anything. This one is confined mainly to turtle heads, so you have to be along some fairly low areas where white turtle head goes. But very, very colorful, supposedly distasteful to birds, and sort of advertises its presence. And it's the one butterfly that thinks you're so invulnerable, you can come up to it like this and just sort of gently lay a net right down on top. I even took a movie of me just sort of sitting down, and that butterfly was sitting in it thinking, "Hey, you're not going to hurt me," but he was wrong. Next slide, please. just an example of what we have. You're going to see all these throughout the summer. A viceroy, one of a couple large fritillaries, banded purple, red admiral, on and on and on. Next slide. But just pretty colorful. Those are the big ones. The little ones are kind of special just in their own way because they're so delicate. Here you're talking about a butterfly that's three quarters of an inch across. Gorgeous little tails on the back corner of the wing. Next one, please. You can see here just this fine, fine sort of fuzz on the hind wing, hind margin of the wing, and then this nice little sort of tail. Okay, next one, please. Just to show some of the varieties, the color patterns, sexual differences, or sometimes seasonal differences in these things. Next, so there's really quite a variety. Actually, if you wanted to catch every or observe every Minnesota butterfly, you're getting up around 130, 135 different species, I think. Here's what the hind wing of a particular hair streak looks like. It's really just pretty to look at under a microscope and try to figure, hey, are you Edwards eye or are you Calanus or what in the world are you? Next one, please. After you've kind of mastered butterflies, you can go to skippers. And skippers have a way of pretty much all looking alike. A stronger body on them. The males, most of the males have a sort of a patch here, a scent patch. Next one, please. Here's just a little bit large to this thing. This aids in sort of identifying. But here you can see all the pattern caused by those pretty little differently colored scales. Next one. That's about a fourth or a fifth of the variety of skippers that we have in the state. But some of them are very, very habitat specific. They'll only be found on prairie remnants, or they're only going to be found in close to sedge meadows, or only close to a particular type of a sedge for a host plant. Next one, please. The skippers that you're going to see out fairly soon are these, I'm sorry, these dusky wings. They're an early one. They'll be found through May and into June, and then they're gone. And that's very, very typical. When you plant a butterfly garden, don't think that you're going to have all these butterflies coming to it, and they're going to be there, and they're going to be there all summer long, and in October they're going to wave goodbye, and they're going to be gone. A lot of butterflies are going to be there for about 10 days, or 2 weeks, or 18 days, and you're not going to see them again for a year. And that's just the natural way of things. They emerge, they're out, and then they're done. Sometimes they'll get a second generation, but you're not going to see, it's just like plants in bloom. You don't see dandelions in bloom all year long. You don't see Dutchman's britches in bloom all year long. You don't see these things flying around your garden all year long. Next one, please. I think we're just about, let's just flip to the next one. I think we're, next, please. Good, mercifully done.
If I can get back to the movies, I like movies better than.
Anyway, here to sort of spoil your thoughts of what you really need in a butterfly garden. Every good butterfly needs sodium, and you don't get sodium from a flower. You get it from coyote droppings, particularly, this is what I found up at Camp Ripley. I could just sort of cruise the roads in my pickup truck and watch where the coyotes are intersecting and leaving their little deposits. And that was a very, very specific way to catch butterflies. The tiger swallowtail there. These are painted ladies coming up to coyote droppings. And Ripley not only has a magnificent population of deer, but also a magnificent population of coyotes and now timber wolves. So there were plenty of these droppings all over the place. And I don't know if there's all this wing waving, if there's some kind of social interaction going on or what. They're a little timid at first. I don't know if they're trying, if he's trying to meet her at Bridgman's for a malt or something or what. But they just congregate to these things, and they congregate to carrion sometimes. They'll congregate to edges of manure piles and the flowers you're going to have in your backyard. Here you see the activity here. I'm by a drainage ditch here. And I noticed that this vegetation had been sort of matted down, and a beaver had been in there, and they come out and sort of, I don't know if he was after a tree up here or something, but you see the activity, and they're going after either the castor, this oily substance that the beavers secrete, or the urine or the feces or whatever it is. But, you know, they're not flying around. They're ignoring every flower in sight. They're down at that beaver, whatever. Dirt roads are sometimes very, very good. Wherever you have a little bit of moisture, lots of butterflies will come down to moist soil. So think about that when you're going to have your complete butterfly garden. Maybe some sand, maybe some mud. Here's a question mark. I think, yeah, it just, and you see what they do when they flip their wings up, suddenly they're much more camouflaged. Try to find one of these things up against a tree sometimes. This is Manila Road in Camp Ripley, and one of my favorite things, I park down here and just walk along the edge of this road, because after, particularly in the morning, after rain, the butterflies would congregate along there. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You could probably find 50 or 75 butterflies along that stretch of road. They're just on the, you know, they're on the sand. They're working their proboscis into the sand just to get moisture, and I presume to get a certain amount of dissolved salts. But it's sort of fun just to know these little things. So, you know, be aware that this is Camp Ripley. You know, they're as clean as can be up there. They're fastidious, but I did find a spent smoke bomb. And this is the most amazing butterfly collecting device I've ever seen in my life. I don't know if it's potassium permanganate or what it is in there, these things are just going crazy. They're probably four different, there's some blues over there, streamside, checker spots, Physiorides, Anthodon, a bunch of things, but they were just massed on this spent smoke bomb. Amazing collecting device, or, you know, be the first one in your butterfly garden club to have your own smoke bomb. You'll often see butterflies like this congregating around a wet area, and you know, there's a wet area all around here, and they're in one square foot. Now, I don't know if they're all bonding or what they're doing down here, but there's something about this one particular area. But these are just a sulfur coming in to pick up whatever it is. Another thing butterflies do is they like to perch. I'm standing up on a hilltop, and I maybe do too many pans, but I want to show you. I'm coming up to a hazel up here, and hazel is kind of a junk tree, but it's a terrific tree for hair streaks and some other butterflies. The males will land up here, and basically, they're hustling chicks. They're waiting for a female to fly by, and you know, I just sort of stand there and search through it. If any butterfly came, a small one came by, this thing would fly up, and they'd meet, and you couldn't follow them, and then they'd be back down. But here he's just waiting for an eligible suitor to come by. Here again. Just sort of sitting there, but you know that the thing that most people want to make a clean backyard. You want to cut down that hazel brush. Here's another. This is a hair streak on oak. If you can get that close with a camera, do it. It's a trick, but I think it's rewarding to try to get in like that. And it's a beautiful colors on the underside, and of course the wind interacts, and you have a hard time holding your camera still too, but. Again, this is a hair streak, but this is a real scrubby-looking oak tree, scrub oaks, 5, 6, 7 feet high. This pair did manage to get together, so the feeding, mating. Oh, here is a female. She doesn't like the male coming around. So I hope you can see it. She's flooding her wings very fast. She's preventing this male from trying to mate with her. He's trying again and again, come on, honey, come on, and she's saying, oh, honey, I've got a headache, and so there's all this, but she's just in there just constantly, so it's rejection, so he goes down to the local marigold, I guess, and drowns his sorrow in nectar. But and this is typical. I see how skippers, a lot of the grass skippers, hold one pair of wings down and the other pair up. But you can see that proboscis coming down in there, down in there, down in there, taking that nectar. But life is not all hustling chicks and drinking and bonding with the guys. This one came down for a little sip of nectar, and there was a spider waiting for him. I saw this, you know, this butterfly like that. And I said, what is your problem? Well, here's this, you can't barely see, there's a camouflaged white crab spider right here that has absolutely reduced that innards of that butterfly to dinner. And here again, this is just a monarch on a metal blazing star. So I want to talk, I'll give you I guess I'm going to call it the Hansen tongue-in-cheek formula for your butterfly garden. The first thing you need for a butterfly garden, of course, you need a coyote. There's no wildflower. There's absolutely no wildflower anywhere in the world that can bring in butterflies like this. If you can find me one, do it. That is fairly fresh coyote droppings, and it's untoppable. Pardon me? I'm not sure. There were no dogs at Camp Ripley, and there are no dogs in our neighborhood. But if you have a toad, if you have a dead toad, work him into the dirt with your heel, like this pickup truck did. The Blues will love you for it. You know, you don't even need plants. You know, you don't need to worry about the rabbits eating your plants. You just get some toads. And if you're next to a army ammunition disposal dump, climb over the fence and get some of these smoke bombs, and you know, have a 4th of July party. And you should don't ever cut down a little beaked hazel tree or a little scrub oak tree that's about this high, because you do need these things. You need thistles. Thistles are a wonderful nectar source. Skippers like this absolutely love thistles. What else is bad? Horiolissum, very common weed in disturbed places, but the painted ladies absolutely love stuff like this. These guys do not discriminate, by and large, they don't discriminate between native plants and roadside weeds. The nectar is nectar as far as most butterflies are concerned, and they'll utilize pretty much what's out there. But I'm going to go sort of through a season with you, butterfly season, plant season. This was a few years back, but it's my little sand prairie that I created here, the blue grama sticking out. And in front of these rocks, I planted some pass flowers. And thank God there are pass flowers in the spring. As the snow melts, here comes this little thing we call a gosling, the bud of a pass flower sticking up through the snow. The snow melts, they get a little bit bigger and a little bit more color in them until finally, oh God, winter's over. We made it to another Minnesota or Wisconsin winter, and we have these beautiful looking plants. I've not seen butterflies flocking to pass flower, but I think every garden now to have pass flower, if nothing else, just for the psychological boost, you know, that hey, here comes spring, and plant something like this in your garden. But I'm going to be saying this over and over again. Enjoy the flowers in your garden, but be sure you also get out and enjoy them where they are in nature. This is a little hillside that I found down by Hastings. It's grazed, and I think there's so many pass flowers here just because it is grazed, but it's absolutely stunning to see this many pass flowers in one place. And you cannot recreate something like that in your garden. Go down and find these little areas and enjoy an April like that when they're... is that in focus for everybody? Okay, another good one is prairie smoke. Not so much for butterflies, but for your own gratification. It's a pretty thing. The leaves are green in the spring when the snow melts. You can see some flowers early on. Actually, it's coming into bloom now. And grow it for the insignificant flowers. Grow it for these beautiful little seed heads that they have. But also grow it for... this sort of, if you can get a bunch of them together. This is actually just a roadside up at Camp Ripley. The prairie smoke is just a lovely looking wildflower when the thing is in seed. Anyway, this is a roadside, back to nature now, this is a roadside along in Camp Ripley. The marsh marigolds are out, as I'm hoping they're going to be here. Who's this? Yeah, sure. Blanding's turtle came out about the same time, and we tried to stare each other down, and he won. But anyway, here she is, up from El Paso or Houston or Dallas or someplace, on her way to Hudson's Bay or maybe Brainerd or Cragen's Resort. I'm not sure. But anyway, a painted lady coming up, nectaring at marsh marigolds. And marsh marigolds are early, they're an early source of nectar. You can easily find a variety of butterflies, at least painted ladies send some blues at marsh marigold. Here again, whether it's domestic or native, the distinction isn't too clear to a butterfly. There were scores of painted ladies at these lilacs at abandoned farmsteads at Camp Ripley. So lilac is a real good source of nectar, something to bring in butterflies. And if you want painted ladies laying their eggs, you want Antenaria or pussy toads. Very, very short thing, but we actually have problems with so many larvae. And you don't need big, showy plants to attract butterflies. This is a little rock crest that's about 3 inches high that's attracting one of these sharp-veined whites. Here again, it's a early spring thing. You'll see it in May and early June, and then it's gone. Who knows what this one is? Sure, bird's foot violet, gorgeous looking thing, a source of nectar early in the spring. There's a particular skipper I'm going to be after looking for, looking right on bird's foot violet. Best place I know for bird's foot violet is called Gray Cloud Dunes. It's in southwestern Washington County. The Mississippi River's down here. 3M used to dump all their toxic waste here, so they think they're embroiled in a bunch of litigation that they can't develop it. But it's a very, very sandy area, and if you get there maybe in another week or so, you're going to see an absolutely magnificent display of bird's foot violet there. It was so blasted windy this day, I thought I was sandblasting my lens. But bird's foot violet is a nice nectar source for adults, but it's also good for a larval source for food for a lot of the fritillaries, these large fritillaries that'll be out later on. They're I would almost say confined to violets. But pretty thing, if you can get any kind of violet, particularly bird's foot violet, going in a garden, you've got a good potential source for both a nectar source for attracting adults and a how about this one? Who knows what this thing just coming on? Pecoon, sure. A couple different species in Minnesota. Again, pecoon is where beautiful yellow plant. It's an intense yellow thing. I think it's a gorgeous looking plant. I've taken what's called a dusted skipper at this several times. I've observed dusted skippers at the pecoon several times, and it's just a good attractor. So don't ever try to transplant one that has a long root, and they die in transplanting. So if you can find one, or just enjoy them. How many people have gone on the Capitol Trail, that bike trail that goes in and out of North St. Paul? The new Fleet Farm that they're putting up is right here. North St. Paul is back a quarter of a mile, and you're rollerblading or you're going on your bike trail right here, and here's Pecoon right down in that ditch between Highway 36 and the Capitol Trail. So lovely looking thing, and it does attract. Here's a hummingbird moth or a sphinx moth. It'll be, I want to say, late May, coming up. We hope.
Dry
soils. Yes, very dry soils. Yes, sandy soils. Painted lady on there. And I think I had, okay. Little tiny thing, sort of fun to have in a garden is a blue-eyed grass, a very, very small, sort of a delicate-looking plant. No butterflies. Shooting star, I'm not sure that's really a whale of a good butterfly one, but I included, I think you ought to make an effort just to find this one location down on Highway 56 in southern Minnesota. The shooting star SNA is here, and this site is about a quarter of a mile further on. And you get down to a Nature Conservancy Prairie, in a Hayden Prairie, I think it's called, in Iowa, a gorgeous site. This again, this is more bumblebee stuff, but I just take it because they're so beautiful and they're so accessible. If you head southeast out of Hastings on, I think it's 318 or 316 or 319, there's a stand about a mile and a half out of town around the 1st of June. It just has this gorgeous, gorgeous Shoei penstemon in there. I think you can see the trucks going by, the cars going by on the highway. Everybody's zooming by. I'm in there having the time of my life looking at all these wildflowers. And it's funny, there was two guys on bikes, and I said, hey, come on down and look. And they said, no, we've got to make 60 miles today. And I said, how sad. Why can't they just take the time to get out and look at some of this stuff? Shoei Pensterman, here's Tradescantia or spiderwort. I think I was taking pictures of bees and bumblebees on it. No butterflies on it that time, but sometimes you have to sort of take what you can get. But here again, often after nectar. One of my favorite plants is called cream indigo. It's sort of arching raceme on this plant, and indigo. Cream indigo is a legume, so that's related to clovers, alfalfa, peas, beans, sainfoin, astragalus, local weed. They're all good nectar sources, and they're also all good larval host plants for a number, particularly of butterflies, particularly blue butterflies. Here again, this is Highway 56 down in southern Minnesota. The stuff grows in the roadways, and it's really worth, you're doing 55, doing 60, just pull over the side of the road, take a look what's down there, yellow star grass, prairie phlox maybe, and here are these racemes of cream indigo. This is white indigo. I'm looking at a plant that's about this big and this big around, and if you're heading east on 694, you're going to swing up north. You're driving that semi, you're going to swing up north to Duluth. Those white indigos are right here. So they're readily available. All you have to do is park by the apartment buildings and climb over and take a look at them. Best to wear a, best to look official, wear some neon vest or something like that. this plant, honest to God, it's about this big. And in the fall, you can't put your arms around it. And there, everybody doing the cars, back and forth. Here is a blue indigo, not quite native to Minnesota, but it's a beautiful herbaceous shrub. Again, about 3 feet tall and makes something about like this, gorgeous. And we had something that never bothered to identify, but had a colony of some kind of little blue caterpillar eating the thing. What's this?
Lupin.
Yeah, sure, lupin. I've seen this patch of lupin for 40 some years. Up by Lewis, Wisconsin, the host plant of the federally endangered Carnia blue butterfly. I didn't see any butterflies on it that day, but it's interesting because there's an association with the larvae and a bunch of ants. So butterfly gardening is seeing the adults come, it's seeing the larvae eat up your plants you carefully planted, it's seeing the ants fend off the enemies of the larvae. This is a desmodium. If you want another legume that makes sort of almost a hedge type thing, this is on a roadside beautiful looking plant. You can buy that from the native plant producers. It makes a pretty hedge, say 3 feet high, and again, good nectar source for the adults. Good source of food for the larvae. This is just cultivated red clover. Again, it doesn't make a difference whether it came from a Eurasia or what. The butterflies like the nectar. They're not discriminating. Here's a blue, can't tell from here, on L-site clover or a white Dutch clover. And you can see this in roadsides. You don't need to kill those, quote, weeds in your lawn. You don't have to put the 2,4-D out there. Here I'm walking underneath a power line right away. Lots of wild blackberries or wild raspberries. A little bit of hawkweed in there. Berries, the brambles are excellent nectar sources for bees. When I kept bees, I'd always look forward to the honey crop off of blackberries and raspberries. Here's it's a streamside crescent, I'm not sure, but a pair of crescents, just nectaring on these things. Excellent source of nectar. There were butterflies all over underneath that thing. Here's a skipper. You see all those skippers sit, hind wings down like that, and front wings up at this angle. And very, very characteristic. I hope I'm getting somebody to kind of say, hey, maybe I ought to get that camera out here. It's fun. if you had a choice of two groups of plants to plant, one would be gay feather, the other would be milkweed. This is just common milkweed. Why do you plant it? Well, because it's a wonderful source of food for the larvae of monarchs. Here's this guy growing big and fat and strong, eating that. If you don't like common milkweed, you can plant, what's this one called? Swamp milkweed, sure. Swamp milkweed, red milkweed, butterfly, incarnate. It's a gorgeous, gorgeous color. It's an intense. There's nothing pastel about this thing. This is it's a strong. It's like ironwood. It's a nice strong color and a really kind of a display plant. It'd be about 3 feet high. How about this one?
Butterfly.
Sure, butterfly weed. Nature kind of going like this, and then man in the background on these straight rows of prune Christmas trees. I had to get that juxtaposition in there, but gorgeous. Give Kodachrome credit here. It's a lovely, lovely looking orange. It's the most intense orange I think I can of any flower in Minnesota. If you don't like something quite so strong, you can go a little bit. Anyone know what this one is? Sure, Sullivan's milkweed, found in Iron Horse Prairie, southern Minnesota. How about this one? Green milkweed, found on a hill prairie. Across from a Simstone plant just outside of Redmond. Beautiful, beautiful prairie to go up and poke around on. Here's I was at the same place, a Coreopsis, a yellow plant though, 18 inches high. It's awful windy that day. Plant one or six or eight in your garden to have the bright yellow, but then go through Red Wing, go about 2 miles out of Red Wing, great big noisy cement plant on the west side of the road. Plant or stop and park on the east side of the road and climb up this roadside prairie sometime in early to mid-June and get a sight of these coreopsis. It's absolutely beautiful. And the butterflies and the insects and the lead plant and on and on and on and on. It's too steep to be, it's hard to climb, it's hard to go up. So obviously sheep weren't up there, cows weren't up there. It's an absolutely lovely a lovely, lovely place, and you're just panning across. It was just an ocean of yellow. One of my favorite plants, not real beautiful, but what is it? Sure, bergamot or monarda. Here again, a wonderful, a minty thing. It's a wonderful sort of weedy thing. It'll get going in roadsides. It'll get going in old fields. You'll see a lot of this stuff in. Disturbed land. It's, once you get it going in your garden, you wonder why you bought it sometimes. Not one plant, not two plants. You're going to end up with 15 or 20 or so in a couple years. If you're lucky enough to own an old field like this fellow along, come on there. This, and it's interesting. You turn a botanist loose in a field like this and she's bored in about 10 minutes. But you turn an entomologist loose in a field of bergamot, and he can play with his toys for hours. Here I am with a camera on banded purple, on bergamot, a little bit of black-eyed Susan in there too. Here again, nectaring. Just a little closer. This is a early. She has not been kicking around for a long time. But nice colors on that thing. I'm trying not to block your view, so I'm kind of peeking around here. Oh, here's I've tried to get this sphinx moth. You don't have to confine it to butterflies. Moths are almost as good. And these day-flying moths that look almost like a hummingbird, absolutely beautiful little guys. Here, I think it's just going to walk right around that bergamot. But that is a real thrill to see. I've seen several of these species in Minnesota. Let's see, what are we here? Oh, if you want some kind of a little shrub, New Jersey tea is a good one. Dense masses of tight white blossoms on this thing. Also, I believe larval host plant for some dusky wings, but makes a shrub maybe 2 feet across, 18 inches high, a really nice mound. That's New Jersey tea. No butterflies out on this day, but the thing was in full bloom. When I got my prairie mix from Prairie Restorations to do my acre prairie, the oxeye was one of the plants in it. Very easy to establish from seed, so if you're doing a large area, use oxeye, black-eyed Susan, another one that's pretty easy to get going from seed. If you're a little smaller area, you can get some of the domesticated ones. This is called Goldsturm, black-eyed Susan. It stays in bloom much, much longer. Stays in bloom for 5 weeks, I think. Really intense. I'm not seeing butterflies here, but I'm more pollen-eating beetles coming around to this thing. Okay, yeah, here's a fritillary on nectaring on black-eyed Susan. So, you know, I did shoot a lot of monarchs. I have to apologize. But a nice mix of, you know, black-eyed Susan, some oxeye, fragrant hyssop, agastache in there, all good nectar sources, and you get them together with grasses and you have a you know, something really pretty attractive. Here again, just a monarch on black-eyed Susan, I think that's on oxeye. Petals aren't down far enough. And it is. Oh, if you want the prairie equivalent of a tree, get yourself a compass plant. Nice big showy blossoms. I'm kind of walking up the stem of this thing. These compass plants can get, 5 to maybe 7 feet tall. And then these just, great big blossoms up on the top. Nice and showy. And if you have room for it in your back garden, get some, because they're really awfully pretty. But milkweeds is one group. The other group is, what's this thing? Sure, blazing star. There are about 5 species in Minnesota, and these things are magnets for butterflies. Here, this blazing star was surrounded by Indian grass and big blue stem in my prairie, and it's pulling in monarchs on now. This is a sunny day, but I think my next one. Okay, a couple different kinds of blazing stars. This one's prairie blazing star, kind of nice. Pretty sure it's the prairie blazing star. Nice tight heads on the thing. A good plant for sort of medium to the sort of moist conditions. We have a real dry site. Anyone know what this one is? Cylindric blazing star. Maybe only 4, 5, 6 blossoms on it, but it'll grow, say, 12, 14, 16 inches high on a limestone, a rocky outcrop. And here's a little skipper again. Sipping nectar at the cylindric blazing star. Dotted blazing star, the flowers are sort of a more lineal form, but a beautiful plant. This is at the Bayport Scientific Natural Area, just south of Bayport, and in one of these ditches that the all-terrain vehicles or dirt bikes made several years back. Rough blazing star, clusters are, you know, they're farther apart, but again, this typical, you know, pretty pinkish violet. I think it's a very, very attractive flower, very good attractor for bees, for butterflies, and just, you know, easy to establish. This is just a roadside along a dirt road in Wisconsin. Here again, I was just, had some film in my camera and wanted to get out and take a shot of that. Maybe metal blazing star with these longer pedicels on them here. But I think, and then there's a cobalt blazing star, which is a selection of a, okay, here's a blazing star. See, it's buried, it's only about 2 feet high, it's buried in a big blue stem, and the monarch still can, you know, see it or smell it or whatever they do, come down and nectar on those things. So milkweeds and blazing stars, those are your two kind of essential plants, particularly if you want to haul in monarchs. Well, we're getting kind of, butterflies are pretty, hummingbird moths are pretty. How about this guy? What's this one? Anyone know?
Bee-fly?
Sure, a bee fly. Pretty little guy, this long, what's that? 3/8 of an inch long, 1/2 inch long, but just fun as can be to watch. Here's the Leonardis, blazing star skipper on blazing star, naturally. Here she is, I think. This is down at Kellogg Weaver sand dune areas, and there again, just the add-on emergence time coincides with the bloom time on blazing stars, and a frequent visitor. If you get down to Kellogg Weaver, you should be lucky enough to see what's called a regal fritillary. This is where they're found in the eastern part of Minnesota, and this is the only time I've ever picked up a roadkill butterfly. Was my one specimen of a regal fritillary. Very, very nice, but I've read of people seeing hundreds of them down there at the proper time. But I'll be satisfied with monarchs too, and anything on blazing stars. So I think you can see the blazing stars are really essential here to any kind of a prairie or butterfly garden. This is just the top head of a metal blazing star, and you see these long pedestals that support the bloom. This is the hillside out at this Bayport Scientific and Natural Area, and their blazing stars are just up in these sort of gullies coming down here. Dotted again, just to show the kind of the more lineal shape of those blossoms. Kellogg Weaver Sand Dunes is a wonderful place to visit. This Bayport Scientific and Natural Area, another place. I go down to the Lost Valley Scientific and Natural Area. Okay, we're getting on. Oh, yeah, weeds. Spotted knapweed, don't try to plant it. Hawkweed, they're probably going to come in whether you want it or not. But there are some wonderful nectar sources. Leafy spurge is a good one. It's a terrible plant. Spotted knapweed is a wonderful nectar source. It's a terrible plant. I'm not sure about this hawkweed. Another good native, though, is Joe Pieweed. Grow 5-6 feet tall in fairly wet areas. Maybe green-headed coneflower in there, too. I'm not sure. But a good nectar source, and there again, things kind of like to kind of perch up on top of it. Here's a hair streak up here, nectaring. She almost looks sort of moribund. But now we're getting into, we're well past May, June, July. We're getting into August on these things, and I wish I had a good picture of ironweed too. It's a very, very similar plant to this, except it's a much more intense kind of a color. This is what you can see. If you do get these things established in your backyard, you can. We always recommend like swamp milkweed. If you have a heavy soil, swamp milkweed, ironweed, Joe Pye weed. They're all good, good nectar sources. Good for bringing. In this case, it's hair streak. Just another shot. Okay, but it's just here's one monarch up there. Another monarch down here on hair streak. And I hope this thing is in. Okay, getting along, this is just in a wet area, just panning across boneset and Joe Pieweed, and I was sitting there where the bees and butterflies are on. How about this one? Who knows what this one is? Sure, cardinal flower. What's it main use for in a garden? Sure, hummingbirds. Hummingbirds, they love that bright red. And that's on the long end of the spectrum. The insects, by and large, don't see it. You got about five species, or five, probably more species of goldenrod in the fall. I kind of shy away from the weedy Missouri goldenrod or Canada goldenrod, even though it does attract things. Gray goldenrod is a nice one. That you can kind of keep in control. Showy goldenrod, I think, is coming up next. That's a nice sort of a columnar thing. Likes a fairly dry soil. Something for a little heavier soil, and it's a fairly tame. How about, who knows what this one is?
Stiff.
Yeah, sure, stiff goldenrod. We kind of like to call it, has sort of a helicopter landing pad up on the top of it for monarchs or whatever. But any of your goldenrods, they're kind of at the end of the season, and they, how about this one? Bottle gentian. Beautiful plant. The bumblebees fight their way in. How about this one? Cream gentian, sure. again, not for butterflies, but hey, we're putting closure on the butterfly season for the year when you start seeing the gentians. If you're lucky enough to be up at the Bayport Scientific and Natural Area, you see, who's this?
That's blue
gentian. Yep, the blue are the prairie gentian. There are a number of those up by Prince Gentian I find along Highway 56 on the way down by past Dodge Center. Dodge Center. Anyone know what this little guy is? About 18 inches high, tiny, tiny blossoms on it?
Stiff gentian.
Yeah, stiff gentian. Beautiful little thing. If you can get some stiff gentian, too bad it's a biennial, but it's absolutely gorgeous and it's late. When there's practically nothing else around for bumblebees or butterflies to feed on, you have stiff gentian that they can come on in on. So I'm kind of wrapping up the butterfly year here. I think I'm going to finish off with one of the asters. How about this one? Anyone know? Sure. New England aster. I've seen frost on New England aster blossoms. Strong plant, maybe 4 feet high, and if the thing would just stop blowing. This is called a fire rim tortoiseshell or Milbert's tortoiseshell. He's getting ready for winter. He'll be overwintering and just getting the last bit of nectar, and I guess that's it. So could we have some things? Thanks very much for the home movie session. I don't know if anyone's going to get those rusty old Super 8s out, but I think it beats video. I think you have a video about this big. And can I answer any questions on what you ought to have in the garden or what you saw here today? I don't know where you can get smoke bombs. Maybe you know someone with a coyote. I'm not sure, but
you know what they're looking for? They're looking for potassium.
I think it's a salt imbalance. Could you help me? Do you know?
I think it's minerals.
Yeah. Urine. They also go to urine. I tried numerous times, and I can't do whatever beaver is able to produce. I don't know. I left my marking posts all over Camp Ripley, and I think I've attracted one butterfly to it. So I feel inferior to what those beavers are able to crank out of their kidneys. But.